You're listening to Howard Leader on BBC Lincolnshire Medium Wave this afternoon because of sporting fixtures being covered on FM at the moment. If you are interested in the football, of course, that's the place to listen to that. And on BBC Radio Humberside. And I mentioned earlier on that I've got a bit of a privilege at the moment. I don't often get some extra help on this programme. But we've got Jonathan, who's a graduate of Lincoln University and just doing your work experience with us for, well,
for the foreseeable future, as long as possible.
That's good. Already making a great contribution, and I deeply appreciate
thank
that,
you.
Jonathan.
Thank you.
And the task I set you this week, I sound like Alan Sugar.
I'm not fired, hopefully.
No, you're not fired yet. No. The task I set you this week was to just have spend a bit of time in the record library, because there are some, there are a lot of LPs and things in there that aren't played often enough to be part of the regular catalogue.
Yes.
So just to have the chance to get in there and have a good look and see what you can find is always useful. And I'm forever pulling things out and thinking, God, I didn't know that was there. So I said, come up with three gems if you can. So you've had a good look. What have you found?
Yes, well, I've got a few songs today. Firstly, it was actually terrific fun going through the Grand Library. Obviously, you know, as a record collector, it was just like a gold mine in there, essentially. I was pulling out records, and I found one by the Kansas City Orchestra run by Benny Moten, which is very interesting, because when you look at what was being done in the late 20s in New York and Chicago, the Kansas City jazz was very, very different. And this song I'm about to play is actually so popular it stayed in the catalogue until the late 40s. So it was essentially made the transition to a jukebox hit. And they, I think RCA even did it on 45 at some point as well.
And Billy Moten himself was highly respected, very...
very talented pianist.
And a great encouragement, I gather, to other musicians. He was really well thought of, wasn't he, in that regard?
Yeah. A lot of musicians made the transition to having their own bands through Benny Moten, so Count Basie for one of them, for example. And the Kansas City jazz style, it marks the transition from big band to bebop, essentially. I think it's very underrated. Obviously, you know, it was essentially limited to one city, but the jazz that came out of there is so different to anything else that came out of America at that period. So, yeah, it's very, very interesting to listen to that.
You've chosen a great number. I like
indeed.
This one. South. Thank you. There you go, Benny Merton and his Kansas City Jazz and a number called South. Jonathan's first find, first gem from the Grand Library. Yeah, good choice, Jonathan.
Thank you.
I like that. It's a natural sort of follow-up because you've discovered the... I think this is the only CD we have in the library currently here at Lincolnshire that features the music of Bix Beiderbecke.
Yes.
But tell us a bit of... Tell us what you know about Bix.
Well, Bix was originally how I got into this music, through videos on the internet, etc. He was born in Iowa, in a town called Davenport, and displayed amazing musical genius from a young age. He was picking out tunes on the piano from a very young age and playing them back. And when he went away to, well, that's like a college, yeah, a college, I guess, he sort of fell in with what was then seen as the wrong crowd, these musicians playing this wild music, this jazz, etc. And of course his parents disproved, and it's all very, it's in a sense, it's almost like a fairy tale. There's a whole legend around his life, and his sound is absolutely unique, and know what, I don't think his records do him justice, and everyone that heard Bix play live said that it was just an amazing experience, you know, to hear him, because his improvisation and the way he was playing was many, many years ahead of his time, and it's so tragic that he died young because of drink. Yeah. And of course drink was a big part of his life, and he died in 1931.
Yep. Okay, well, let's hear this track. You've chosen Since My Best Girl Turned Me Down. I don't think I've heard this one before, so I'm looking forward to it. Spiderbeck, since my best girl turned me down. And Jonathan was just telling me that they have an annual Bix Fest.
Yes, they do, yeah.
In America.
Yeah. I guess because of the way that Bix died, and it's, you know, people who die young, they tend to have some kind of quasi-religious status evolves around them, and Bix Spiderbeck's no exception. People visit his grave, and they play bands there, and then there's all sorts of festivals, and it actually does, you know, it does a lot of favours for the city of Davenport. But yeah, there's definitely some kind of, I wouldn't call it a cult, but a very big following of Bix Spiderbeck.
Yeah. Well, you bring us up to more modern times with the third item that
yes.
you found.
Yes.
I really am quite genuinely excited about this, because I didn't know that this album was even in our library. So well done for unearthing this.
That's
one.
That's all right.
So tell me a bit about it. This is the, they call it the Midnite Follies Orchestra. Mm.
Well, I pulled this out because I recognise the name, which was originally used by Jay Whiddon in London in the late 20s, who broadcast from the Hotel Metropole. And I gather that Keith Nichols must have used this name when he reformed this orchestra. This side in particular has very kind of happy connotations for me. When I went to Whitley Bay last year, I was listening to this song that we're going to play in a second, and there was an American lady sat on my table, and she came over and she said, well, you know, I saw your feet going to the beat, and you've got the beat and you've got the rhythm. Do you want to come and dance with me? And of course, I'd never done ballroom. I was wearing sticky trainers. I didn't go there with intention of dancing. And before I knew it, I was up in front of an 11-piece band. And it was terrific, terrific fun, because, of course, the music's made for dancing. So when I saw this song, and of course I saw Keith Nichols last year, obviously he looks a bit younger on the LP cover than he did when I saw him, but it just brought back so many happy memories of the kind of euphoric feeling of dancing to the music.
What a great story. Let's hear then the Midnite Follies Orchestra Truckin'.
Something new, a dance to do up here in Harlem, so someone started trucking. As soon as the news spread round, the folks downtown came up to Harlem, saw everybody trucking. Well, it didn't take long before the hi-hats are doing it, Park Avenue and it all over town. You'll see them scuffling, shuffling, trucking along. It spread like a forest blaze, became a craze, and thanks to Harlem now everybody's trucking. Truckin', truckin',
whoa,
everybody's truckin',
whoa,
everybody's truckin',
shoo-wee-wah, all over town, spreading rhythm around,
truckin',
whoa,
everybody's truckin',
whoa,
everybody's truckin',
shoo-wee-wah,
truckin' on down from Harlem. It didn't take long before the hi-hats are doing it, Park Avenue and it all over town. You'll see them scuffling, shuffling, truckin' along. It spread like a forest blaze, became a craze, and thanks to Harlem now, everybody's trucking.
Yes, well, a real gem from the Graham Library. And very grateful to Jonathan for unearthing those tracks, particularly that album. I didn't even know we had this, so I shall definitely make more use of the Midnite Follies Orchestra. And the vocalist there was Johnny M.